Hello ladies and gents, welcome back to a new episode of Britain's Lost and Living Pubs. We're now going to go find a beautiful relic that we're lucky enough to have called the Cat and Fiddle. I am now in the Peak District of Derbyshire and we pulled over just before we take our venture on what is the most dangerous road in the UK, so hopefully we'll survive it. I have a stunning and wonderful driver who's more than capable, but this road sees the most deaths and accidents on it apparently than anywhere else on average, and motorcyclists love this road, and it's nicknamed after the Cat and Fiddle Road, which is actually at the summit of this road. So driver, would you like to do the honours as I go through some of my notes here? And the Cat and Fiddle, by the way, is said to be the second highest pub in all of England, the highest apparently being Tan Hill in Yorkshire. I don't know if you're familiar with Tiffany.
Yeah.
It sits at 1,000. Safety, always put your belt on. It sits at 1,689 feet above sea level. So that's 515 metres above sea level. And this place can have extreme weather conditions. Obviously in the heat, it's meant to be a heat wave this week, but in the cold this place gets unreal, you know. On the way back I think we'll have to film some of that, you know, because you can't see how beautiful it is. What I'm looking at now, it's absolutely stunning. This area is amazing. I'll just look at some notes here before we actually talk about the pub. But this is said to be the most dangerous road in the whole of England, and it was built in 1823, allegedly. The road itself is named after the pub which lays at the top. I found this source here on dangerousroads.org, which says, sweeping between Macclesfield and Buxton in the county of Cheshire in England, Cat and Fiddle Road is the name of a widowmaker road because of its mounting death toll. It's known as the most dangerous road in the UK. This road presents an unacceptably high risk to users. Between 2011 and 2013, there were 34 crashes. Between 2007 and 2011, there were 44 fatal crashes or people wounded on the road. I don't see how you'd survive if you're flying off this road. Between 2002 and 2006, there were 35 on this road. It's easy to see how its nickname came around. The road tops out at 516 metres above sea level, and it is notorious for its severe bends, steep drops, and edged by dry stone walls. And due to the nature of this road, it's a bit like Isle of Man, when they all go over there, because it's so treacherous. It really does attract a lot of motorcyclists and, you know, shall we say, car enthusiasts. But the pub at the top has a story of its own, because it's also got stories of tragedy. And it sat here for quite a while. It sat dormant for a while, actually. And people thought it was going to be shut down. But one particular story is of a young chap who I've got written here. And there it is, I can see it, yeah. Right at the top of the hill. Now this young chap, he was walking with two friends around here, and they sought refuge in that pub, because the pub was mainly built, well, I've got the notes here. So Henry Critchley was forced to seek shelter in the derelict house. And he was with two friends who decided to stay in the house, but he went on ahead. And as he was making his arduous trip over the hills from Buxton to Macclesfield, he didn't make it. And he obviously underestimated the cold and the conditions from this pub. And he was found dead a while later, frozen. But he's not the only one. There's a story of 15 people that found themselves stranded in here for a couple of days, because these areas sometimes when it snows, that's it, you're not moving. So there's one particular story here in 1937 that 15 people were stranded in the inn when the weather took a turn for the worse. It took 28 hours for a snowplow to be able to reach them. So we're basically at the pub, the road's not that long, and it took 28 hours for the snowplow to get through this. The licensee kept the ground, kept the group entertained with cards and gossip. In 1940, the pub was again effectively cut off from civilization. The licensee, James Clark, and his wife Dorothy, her mother and a friend, were left to survive on tinned fruit for a whole week. So this pub is now a whiskey and gin distillery. Now I'm going to go in and try the whiskey or the gin, most likely the whiskey, and see what it's all about. But if I just ask the cameraman to turn around and you'll see where we are. Sorry about the wind. Cyclists here. As we come up, there's a couple of bikes over there, there's like a set out the front, and these are the houses here that people would have sought refuge in. So when this was first built, it was originally built because this was such a dangerous road that you'd have to stop halfway most of the time. They'd need a refuge, like if you was in Scotland and they build a little boffy or a cabin in the Highlands in case the weather turns awful. This place would be the difference between life and death for the traveller on the road. So we were in Derbyshire, now we're in Cheshire. When we started, when I was talking from the car, we was in Derbyshire, now we're in Cheshire. The most fantastic news to accompany one's scotch, or in this case, whiskey. Sorry mate. So if we have a look here, we'll answer a couple of questions. It's a distillery. And you have to book ahead, you can have venues and functions here and so on. But I think, if we're lucky, we might get a bit of special treatment. I think the chap said he might let someone show us around. So let's go in and buy a drink. So bear in mind, they're making their own whiskey, their own gin. So look at this. And they supply, obviously, wine and stuff like that.
Must
be a very strange experience being a landlord here. Yeah. Or having been a landlord here.
I'll bring you back again. I hope you'll take it.
One of the managers said to me, he'd like me to make it clear that we are very alive, we're very functioning, not always capable to handle people just turn up, and they like people to book ahead, but as you can see, it's vibrant in here, it's more alive in here than it looks when you're approaching it. So this is the whiskey there. I'm actually really interested to try this now. I thought it was just gin, but now I know they actually make whiskey, I'm obviously going to get one of them.
You've got loads of different blends.
I said to the chef, I said to him, I love Scotch. He went, no, this is English whiskey. I said, don't worry.
Oh, look, that's what
you
need.
Okay.
That's how you know a place knows what it's on about.
A Glencairn glass. You see? That's what you see Luke Uncage and myself drink out. Glencairn glass.
Yeah, so we have a range of blends available that I can certainly give you samples of. We have a couple of single malts available, both private casks. So we have an 8-year-old single malt from Ben Nevis or a 24-year-old single malt from Speyside Distillery, both private and Scotch whiskies. Also, we have our blended selections coming for you today.
Come in closer.
In that case, I'll have the Ben Nevis.
Were you wanting any mixes for that one, so to tasting?
No, I just want to understand. Have you got a Glencairn glass? Yeah. Thank you.
This is the 8-year-old Ben Nevis. So what happens with the single malts that we have available, we send our bottles and our spring water up to Scotland. It's bottled at the distillery and then we send it us back. With Scottish rules, they aren't allowed to send the cask out of Scotland. It has to be bottled up there.
Otherwise you wouldn't have Scotch, would it? That's charming, that is.
So we have a couple of things available. The London Dry, which is in my bottle. And then the blue bottle is our Earl Grey gin, which is essentially just the same gin. It's a Earl Grey bag inside, which is essential, which is Chester.
Go on.
What do you have to drink on it?
I don't drink it, so how will I drink it and not dislike it?
So you don't like gin? So I'd probably go for the Earl Grey with a sweeter mixer, a ginger ale or a spiced orange ginger ale.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Let's do that. This is really nice.
Yeah, you've got that now, haven't you?
And also, it's the first place in ages I've seen an actual Glencairn glass.
So when we first opened the building, as you can imagine, it's been empty for 5 years, so there's a lot of renovations to do, it's a complete mess. So we crowdfunded, hoping to raise £50,000 to renovate the inside of the building.
Yeah.
Robinson, it is Robinson to lease building, so they were responsible for the outside.
You're not going
to
hear this, lady.
But all these lovely people who got crowdfunded in order for us to renovate and open the building again, and we managed to raise £75,000.
So would it be safe to say that all of these people hold this place in such high sentimental value? Because there's nothing in them in it for them financially. This is genuinely because they didn't want to see the place go.
And then the next one was just some local companies that did the same.
Oh, companies?
Yes, yeah.
Yes, we do. Tony and Guy, ladies and gentlemen. Tony and Guy. So this is a firm. Did you ever get any of these people come in?
Yes, yeah, so they all got offered tours and...
Come on. Stay near me.
Yes, we do.
Yeah,
so, they all got offered tours, so they've all been and done, or the majority of them should hopefully have been in, done a whiskey or a gin tour.
Yeah.
And it's going to be
better. Yeah. Oh, wow. Now, this is a smoking lounge.
Yeah. Peace. Morning. So our bar's open Monday to Friday, 12 till 5. We asked if you wanted to come and have a drink with us, that you just book a table in advance. Mm-hmm. But we're open. And then at the weekends, this is our gym room, so this is where we hold our gym tours. Then I'll just take you to our event space at the back.
This is beautiful. Are these all original fireplaces?
Yes, and also this floor's the original floor.
Wow.
It's rose up to hip house in some places, but we've managed to restore it all.
This is all fantastic. Oh, and you do functions here, don't you?
Yes, we do. Beautiful.
This is where you have your whiskey tasting.
This is the whiskey
room. I bet it gets real snobby in here, doesn't it?
You know what? No, everyone seems lovely that comes on tours. I think it's just a, rather than like risk of concerns, it's just a lovely day out for people.
My friend would be doing his absolute, if he could see this now, he's got a bar full of rums and whiskies, and this is what he aspires to. This he'd be going over the moon right now. That's absolutely beautiful. So this is specifically for, would you say, gin and whiskey drinkers or just your Scotch drinkers for whiskey drinkers?
So anyone that comes on the tour, if they are whiskey drinkers, we're more than happy to offer them a gin and tonic or gin and tonic instead.
This is first class, honestly. Pretty difficult to place in this as first class. I love the furniture. And these look like they're real as well.
And it's a bit of a camper van blocking the view, but on a nice day, you can just about see the Welsh hills in the background.
Yeah. Oh, what my life, look at this. Love this. What you will be able to get from this actual establishment that they are responsible for. But you've got plenty of other drinks, haven't you?
Yeah, so we've got a small draft selection. We are Robinson's own building, so we've got a small draft selection from Robinson's.
We're going to go outside, have a look at the hills, call it a day. But it's been a lovely little pub, and I think it's well worth coming out. What we will do, quickly, we'll go and look at the smoking section. That's what we'll do. I just don't want to disturb the people out there. So if you just stick your camera from here and have a look. You see, it's a nice little area out there. That would have genuinely been the difference between life and death at one stage. That's absolutely lovely. People don't notice features like that. You see here, you get your nice Glencairn glass with it, see? That's a proper whiskey maker. They know what you want, they know what you need, Bosch. And the great point about the Glencairn glass is the shape keeps it warm, really, really brings the taste and the scent around you, man, and give it a little swirl, first class.
So people would be walking across these lands, following preferably what we see as the road now, and it would be such awful weather that your only hope was to get into one of these structures, which would be there purely to protect you. And then it became a pub later down the line. We can see here on the front. Now, what many people don't know about pubs is why the pictures are what they are. So people think there's just a cat and a fiddle because it's called a cat and a fiddle. Well, it actually goes back to times before most people could read and write. So the cat and the fiddle is obvious to those who would have been illiterate in the area.